Right now, he's an amazing God. I want you to look to your right and tell that person God loves you. Look to your left and tell that person God loves you. It's so good to see you. Let's see. going, but this time we're gonna get our clappers going fast, all right? So I need everyone to get your hands going. Ready, Ray? Give us a beat. Here we go. Here we go. Because of God's love, because of His grace, we are set free from the sins of this world. We are set free from death. Get those hands together, come on. I know we can clap louder than that. smile a little bit. Look at your neighbor and smile. Look at your other neighbor and smile. Josh is just smiling to himself a bit. Let's sing Yes, Lord. Here we go. Nice and loud. We're singing Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I woke up this morning and I got in my car that I knew was gonna start, or I hope would start. And if it didn't start, I'd have another car I could get into. And I pressed my garage door opener, which I knew was gonna open. And I backed out, I drove here, and I had another outfit on. And then it was cool because I had another suit that I could change into for the second service. And I took all these things for granted time after time. And I got here without even thinking what a miracle it is to just be able to get in my own car and drive down here after being in a house that was refrigerated air and all these things. But you know, the one thing I take for granted the most is that I could say this beautiful name Jesus whenever I want to. Did you know that in some countries, if you say the name Jesus, it's a crime? Today, in the middle of this song, Jenny Licking is going to talk about her experience in China. And she was in a place that really wasn't too welcoming about saying that name or proclaiming it. Isn't it beautiful to think we can come into this amazing building and say the name Jesus however many times we want to say it, and we can say it with confidence, and we can say it knowing that nobody's going to look at us and judge us, or we can just say it with as much passion as we want. As we sing this song, there's something about that name. I just want you to think about how many times we take it for granted that we can worship our God however loud or however soft or however we want to do it. What an amazing thing it is to be able to say that and do that. So let's stand and sing, "There's Something About That Name."
My name is Jenny Licking, and I lived in Asia for 6 months. And I just want to come and share a story with you guys about that time. There was an afternoon. I had two good friends of mine. They decided to take me out on an adventure, and they were like, "It's only going to take an hour. It'll be a lot of fun." And I was like, "Okay, cool." And the whole time I was like, "Oh man, an hour. That's all the time I have with these girls. That's all the time I'm going to be able to share with them." And so I took a subway and got to them, and we sat on a bus, and they were like, "Can you tell us some traditions, some holidays that you like?" And so we sat on the bus, and I began to explain to them a candle lighting service on Christmas Eve, and they were like, "Oh, you guys celebrate Jesus on Christmas? That's really strange." And so I was sharing with them, "Yeah, we want to celebrate Jesus. We're really thankful he came to earth, and we're really thankful he was with us, and so much so we missed our bus stop and had to come back." And after our bus stop, we tried to find where we were going. It took us forever, and finally we get up and we're going to go see this tower, and they're like, "It's only going to be an hour." Well, we ended up having 4 hours together because it was a lot longer than we expected. And during that course, they're explaining their history to me of just how kings have abused them and how they've had a hard time. And it was really strange, but I get to share with them, "Well, I have a great king. In fact, our king left his throne and came to us and was willing to die for us." And it was so awesome. And they were like, "Wow, your king's really loving." I was like, "Yeah, he is. He's a great king." And so that was their first time ever hearing the gospel, the first time they'd ever heard that Jesus was willing to die for them, and in fact already had and wanted to invite them into their family. And they're one of the most educated peoples in their country, and it was just amazing. They were 20, 23, and they'd never heard about God before, and that was normal for me. Most of my friends hadn't met Christians, but they were always so excited. They were like, "Man, Christians are loving and joyful." And I was like, "Well, yeah, we are." And it's because of who our King is, and such an amazing God who would come for us. And I just want to encourage you, that's something we can all do. It just takes intentionally meeting somebody and going out to get coffee with them, or going out on an adventure through El Paso with them. And it's something I love to do even here. So thank you all so much for your prayer and for your support as I lived in Asia. Have a great morning.
Let's sing this song one more time, but without any music, just our voices.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Thank you, Elvin. Thank you, Jenny. Thank you, Nikki. Appreciate the wonderful music this morning. Our pastor, as most of you are aware, is away in Decatur, Texas, at First Baptist Church, preaching in view of a call. And so we certainly want to pray for he and Robin as they make their way back on Tuesday, that they would have a safe journey. And again, we want to say thank you. This has been a wonderful year in the life of our church financially. Thank you for the gifts and the offerings that you've given. We're going to vote on a budget at the end of the service today for the new year. Just to tell you where we are, when we vote on that new budget, probably by today, we will have reached that new budget by the giving from this year. So you all have done an excellent job, and we appreciate it very much, and just thank the Lord for the way he has continued to bless us. Would you join me in prayer, please? Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for your steadfast love, for your commitment to your children. Father, we thank you for walking alongside of us and never forsaking us, even when things look bleak, when the future looks scary, when we're not sure about the next turn, we know that you're always there leading us and guiding us, bidding us to follow. So, Father, thank you for that reassurance. Thank you for that hope. And, Father, we just pray that you would be with our church as we go through this time of transition and change. We pray that you'd be with Dr. Lowry and Robin as they travel home, that you will give them a safe journey. Father, we just pray that you would bless both of our churches today, us here in El Paso and First Baptist in Decatur. Pray that you'll just bless the ministries, the missions that go on in both locations. Father, we thank you for the way you've taken care of us this past year, and we look forward to the same kind of response in this coming year. Father, help us to be good stewards. Help us to be mindful of that which you've given to us to share with others in the entire world. Bless us now as we give, that it will be to provide leadership, guidance, strength, missions, ministries, not only in El Paso, not only in Texas, but throughout the world. For it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. If you would turn with me to Jeremiah, the 29th chapter. I want to read a letter to you, a letter written by Jeremiah to the exiles in Babylon. We don't have their letter, we have Jeremiah's letter, but we can ascertain from Jeremiah's letter what their letter was to him because of the way he responds and because of the way he answers their request and their concerns. It's fun how we get to see the other side of the letters throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament. We don't have letters from people, from churches to individuals. We have the letters from individuals to churches. And so we have the case here with Jeremiah in the 29th chapter. He says, "This is the text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the surviving elders among the exiles and to the priests, the prophets, and all the other people Nebuchadnezzar had carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. This was after King Jehoiakim and the queen mother, the court officials, and the leaders of Judah and Jerusalem, the craftsmen and the artisans, had gone into exile from Jerusalem. He entrusted the letter to Elasa, the son of Shaphan, and to Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, whom Zedekiah, the king of Judah, sent to King Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon. It said, 'This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there. Do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Do not let the prophets and diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams you encourage them to have. They are prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my gracious promise to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope in a future. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. My grandfather, Henry F. Allen, died in 1927 of a stroke. When he died, he left a widow, my grandmother, and five children on a farm in West Texas near Winters, just south of Abilene. Grandma Allen was born Hannah Matilda Hale in 1882, the same year our church was organized. She was born that year. And she married at the age of 14, which was not unusual back in the 19th century. It was rather common for women by the time they had gotten to be 14, 15, 16 to marry. She and her husband, Andrew Bishop, had their first child when she was 21. But Mr. Bishop died in 1907 due to an infection, and there were no antibiotics to help him, and so he passed away. My grandmother had two children at the time, and she married my grandfather in 1909. The year he died, at age 67, in 1927, was just 2 years shy of the Great Depression. Now think about it. You're living on a farm in West Texas. Your husband has just died. Your income has all of a sudden decreased. And now in 2 years, you're going to be facing a depression of the economy. Plus, you have five kids to raise. That's what was staring at her in 1927. Grandma struggled through those years with her five children waiting for a pension. My grandfather served in the Spanish-American War from 1898 to 99, so he was entitled to a war veteran pension. She was. And the problem was, my grandfather went by three different names and had at least three different wives, so it took 5 years of an investigation. I see the smiles on your face. It took 5 years of investigation to finally award my grandmother the pension. And she got a whopping $36 a month with back pay for 5 years, which was not a bad sum of money at all at that time. But she needed it desperately. I want you to hear the words of the VA field examiner when he arrived at my grandmother's farm to question her about my grandfather. This is what the examiner said. When I arrived at the Allen farm, I found Mrs. Allen in the field working like a farmhand. My grandmother did what Jeremiah told the Jews to do when tragedy came to their doorstep. After Nebuchadnezzar leveled Jerusalem and took some 20,000 Jews as slaves back to Babylon, the exiles wrote the prophet, who still lived in Jerusalem, to ask, "What do we do now? Where do we go from here? What hope is there? We're nothing more than slaves." And Nebuchadnezzar leveled our city. He destroyed our temple. We have no direction. We have no leader. We have no guidance. What do we do now? And so he replied, "Plant your gardens, build your homes, marry off your children. You're going to be there a long time." 70 years was a figurative number lasting at least two generations, and that's how long they stayed. So when tragedy, disappointment, loss comes to us, we may be just like the Jews to say, "Is there any hope?" We certainly ask, "Well, what do we do now? Which direction do we go?" As I said earlier, we don't have their letter to Jeremiah, but we certainly have his response so we can accurately ascertain what they had in mind. They were lost without a leader, and they said, "What do we do now?" Jeremiah begins by telling the people to live life fully. Did you hear that? Listen to him in verse 5. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there. Do not decrease. Jeremiah did not say, well, pitch a tent and wait a few days. He didn't say, go down and rent a house because it won't be long. He said, build your houses. Make for a permanent stay, not a temporary visit. This is going to be a long time. 2, maybe 3 generations you're going to be there. So live life fully. Start over in a new place. Grow where you're planted. Life is not over, it's only different. Life has not ended, it's only relocated. So make the most of what you have and live life fully. Some of you may feel like the Hebrews, just having moved to El Paso. My wife and I moved here 9 years ago, and we had some adjusting to do. Our daughter and grandsons were here, but we loved Fort Worth, and we had a hard time leaving. I pastored there 13 years, and it was home for us. We had grass, trees, a garden, rain, lakes. Those things we only see in magazines out here in El Paso. But we had those things. You see, El Paso is not Washington State, nor is it Alabama, nor North Carolina, but it can be home if you will allow it to be. I cannot tell you how many military wives have come to El Paso kicking and screaming, don't want to be here, do not like this assignment, never wanted to come to El Paso. 3 years later when they leave, they're kicking and screaming going out the front door. I don't want to leave. We love it in El Paso. In 1999, Kathleen and I went to Europe for 18 days. I was scheduled to lead a seminar, a pastoral care seminar, to some Southern Baptist missionaries in Europe, and that fell through. There was some timing issues, but the church said, go ahead and go. You've already got plane tickets, reservations, so we did. And we spent 18 days in Europe, spent a whole week in Germany. Now, before you go on any kind of a trip, you know, people always give you advice. They're always going to help you. And so they told us, that, first of all, they said, now when you go, only the tourists wear white tennis shoes. Everybody there has black tennis shoes. So you need to get you some black tennis shoes or black walking shoes. So what do? We go down and we get those tennis shoes. We put them on, and when we get to Europe, we get on the first bus, and there's people lined up and down that bus, and guess what they're wearing? White tennis shoes. We're the only idiots in black tennis shoes. All the natives, all the guests, all the tourists, they're in white tennis shoes. And we're going, wow, thanks for the advice. And then we had others to give us great advice. They said, now look, you got to watch it. Over in Germany, the people there are cold, they're not friendly, they're aloof. When you get down to Italy, they're a bunch of snobs, and they fuss and gripe, they're obstinate. And when you get into Paris, boy, you really got to watch the French. They are so snooty and aloof. And guess what? We never found one of those people. Not a one. All that wonderful advice just went down the tube. I told Kathleen after 2 weeks of a great, friendly, and helpful experience in Europe, I said, it's not the Europeans. It's us Americans that got it wrong. We go over there thinking we're something special and everybody's supposed to bow down to us. But we found out in the time there, if you go over there respecting them, loving them, and accepting them, they'll do the same for you. It's all about your attitude. We never had a better place to visit than Germany. I'd go back, I would live there, given the opportunity. Wonderful, wonderful nation to live in, to visit, to be a part of. If you treat people with respect and kindness, you will get the same in return. I think it's all about your attitude. And when you go, don't buy black tennis shoes. Please, don't ever do it. I think this was Jeremiah's counsel as well. He said to the people, have a good attitude. It's not going to change anything. You're going to be there a while. You can gripe and fuss all you want, but if you have a good attitude, you can make the most of your stay while you're in exile. Live life fully. Live life fully. That was his counsel as well. But listen to his next suggestion. Seek the protection and prosperity of the city or village where you live. Seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too are going to prosper. Jeremiah was telling the people to seek out the safety of Babylon. He's saying, if he is safe, you are safe. Don't debate politics or theology. God has placed you there in Babylon due to your refusal to trust him. So seek protection and prosperity, and the Babylonians will take care of you. Can you imagine? The people that just came and destroyed your city, ruined your home, leveled your temple, and Jeremiah is saying to pray for them? I imagine it took a few days for that to soak in. But that's what he's saying. Pray for them, for they will take care of you. Pray for them, because they will bring you safety and prosperity. Scholars say that some 20,000 Jews were taken into Babylonian captivity, and some 70 years later, only 10 to 15,000 returned to Jerusalem. Why? Because many stayed behind in Babylon because they had good jobs and they had income, and they had truly made it home for themselves. If you remember, it was the Apostle Paul that wrote to the church at Rome very similar words to that of Jeremiah. Chapter 13 of Romans, Paul wrote, everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted. And those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and he will commend you. For he is God's servant to do you good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword for nothing. He is God's servant, an agent of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also because of conscience. This is also why you pay taxes. For the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. Give everyone who you owe him. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. How about that? Old Testament, New Testament. Jeremiah, Paul, both saying the exact same thing. While you're there, whether you like it or not, you need to be accepting of those who rule over you because they provide for your safety and perhaps even for your prosperity. Somewhere along the line in America, we've kind of lost that directive. That directive is not based on political views nor moral beliefs, but on the authority of God as ruler over the nations. And somehow we've allowed it to infect us and to change us and to make us kind of weird some days. We've got to remember that President Obama loves the U.S. just as much as George W. Bush did, and that Ronald Reagan loved the United States as much as Lyndon Baines Johnson did. There are times that our pastor reminds us as a staff that the people in the pew love this church as much as we love the church. That doesn't mean we agree with everything we do, but we have to realize that you love this church like we love the church. And just because I interpret the Bible one way doesn't mean that God loves me and not you, nor does it mean that you love the church more than I love the church. Gracious, I've been doing this ever since first sermon was when I was 16. I'm 67. Do the math. Been doing this a while. Yes, I love the church. But I have to be reminded, you love the church too. And we don't always agree, but we love the church. And that's what keeps us going, and that's what keeps us motivated. Lastly, there's a time coming when all will be better. In 1984, my family was glued to the television because, like so many Americans, we were watching this young little girl named Mary Lou Retton do her gymnastics. My, she was something, this girl from West Virginia. Nobody ever heard of her before. She had hurt her leg just a few weeks prior, weren't sure if she was going to be able to participate, but she did, and she won the hearts of the whole world. That big smile when she'd get through with the routine. She scored perfect 10s in one event, took home the gold, was well noted back in 84. We ran into her in the mall in Dallas some weeks after that. She was there for another event. She wouldn't give us her autograph then because she was incognito and just said she couldn't do it. Well, she was the guest speaker of the FCA banquet fundraiser this past spring here in El Paso. So we went and we met her and we finally got her autograph 32 years later. We are persistent, but we finally got her autograph. We told her the story, and she laughed, and she just had a great time with us and us with her. But watching the Olympics in Rio this year made me think of Retton when Simone Biles took the gold for the U.S. women in gymnastics. The announcer over and over said, "Her time has come on the world stage." The time had come. We hadn't had a gymnast quite like Mary Lou until now. And now she's on the world stage. Years of training, discipline, and commitment have paid off. Jeremiah said to the exiles, "The time is coming for you too," as he encouraged them. He said, "The Lord hasn't forgotten you. It won't be today, it won't be tomorrow, but he hasn't forgotten you. There's a time that he's set, and he will come and bring you back home. There's a time set when he will set you free and the world will look differently to you." You see, it wasn't if, it was a matter of when God would restore his people. He would bring back the remnant from exile to start over. And so I say to us today, the same is true for us. What do we do now? Where do we go from here? Well, first of all, we don't panic. We keep doing what this church has been doing for 134 years. We continue to minister. We do our missions. We love each other. We accept each other. We accept the stranger. We make contacts. We continue to do what we started in 1882. It's not that difficult to figure out. We as a church will form our pulpit supply committee. That means there will be a committee that will have a pastor or preacher to come each week for a few weeks. Then there will be an interim committee. And in a month or so, we'll vote on a pastor search committee. So we have people in place. We have a bylaws that we go by. And in those bylaws, it tells us exactly who will do this, that, and the other. And we follow those. We are an independent body. Nobody from Dallas or Nashville tells us what to do. We do what we choose to do. We're an autonomous body of believers, and we dictate our future, and we dictate our present. And so, we will form committees, and those committees will find us people to supply, preach. Then we'll find an interim to come and stay with us for perhaps a year. And then we will have a search committee to go out and find the pastor that God is already preparing to come and be our next pastor here at First Baptist Church. During the Depression, the term hobo became relevant, but not in a bad way. Men and women were out of work and hungry. I've heard stories from some of you and some of my other churches that I've pastored of mothers who would fix enough food for dinner time and they would add a little more to it in case a hobo came knocking at the back door to say, "Can you spare some food?" And they always did spare some food. You see, back in those days, they didn't lock their doors. I mean, I can remember when Kathleen and I first got married, we didn't lock the doors of our house. Sometimes you leave the keys in the car and it'd still be there the next morning. I mean, that's just the way the world was. You didn't think of locking the doors to the house or the car or anything. You just didn't. Now we don't think not to do it. But back then, the door was always open. And so I've had people say to me, yeah, Mother used to talk about how we'd have somebody knock at the back door right around lunchtime, and they'd say, I'm hungry, I haven't eaten in a day. Can you spare something? And Mother would say, I sure can. You see, during those tough days, the back door was always open. People were always ready and willing to help those in need. When tragedies, changes, transitions come our way, we keep doing what we've been doing that works. We keep getting people's names and keep contacting our inactive. We continue to go to the Lord for guidance. We keep doing what we've been doing in a benevolent and caring kind of way. Kathleen and I married on June the 20th, 1969. At the time, minimum wage was $1.60 an hour. Not much. In mid-August, we moved from San Antonio to Abilene so I could go to Hardin-Simmons to finish up my last 2 years in college. We had a whopping $700 in the savings account when we made our move. The problem was, when we got to Abilene, there weren't too many jobs available. And so I was going to school trying to do that, and she was trying to find a job. And so we got to the month of November, and we had $25 in the checking account. Rent was due on Tuesday of that week, which was the first of the month. And she didn't get paid from her job until that next Friday because she had just started a new job as church secretary. So we didn't know what we were going to do. We didn't know how we were going to pay the bills. We didn't know how we were going to eat. I went home from school that Monday afternoon and picked up the mail out of the mailbox, and inside was a letter from V.D. Walters, a former pastor of ours in San Antonio. V.D. wrote and said, I remember those days at Hardin-Simmons, and I know how tough it can be, and I know that money gets tight, so I just sent you a little bit to help you through the tough times. Sent us $25. Well, that paid the rent for that month and a little left over. You see, when you're not sure what to do next, the writers say, wait upon the Lord. The writer of Proverbs says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your paths straight. You see, He hasn't forsaken us. He hasn't left us. He hasn't gone to sleep. He hasn't checked out. He's still with us. He still loves us. He still cares about us. And so when you say, what do we do next? What do we do now? We keep on doing what we've been doing. We keep on being the church at 805 Montana that meets every week, that loves those who are lost, that helps those who are hurting, those who've tripped and fallen, the stranger that comes knocking at our door. We keep being the light in the darkness. We've been doing it a long time. Some of you since 1882. Well, maybe not too many of you, but. And we need your wisdom. We need your stability. We need your help. We need the youth of our church to step up and to step forward and to say, I'll be glad to work here, there, and yonder, wherever you need me. We need to pull together and hold together and know that the Lord has not left us, nor has He forsaken us. What do we do now? We trust in Him. And He will guide us in the path we need to go. Would you pray with me, please? Father, we thank You that You've not left us alone. We thank You that we have a direction to follow, that we have a course to be involved in. Father, we just thank You for the leadership of this church, and we pray that You will bless them as they lead us in the days to come. Father, we pray for our pastor and his wife as they are considering a transition and a change in their own lives. Father, we just pray that You will bless them today and be with them as they travel home on Tuesday. Father, I ask that you would bless our church as we go through the transition and change ourselves over the next few days and weeks and months. Father, wrap your arms around us and keep us safe. For we realize that there are people in our midst who are going through drastic changes as well. Some are facing issues in their own family. Some are facing challenges because of health, because of surgery, because of cancer. And so, Father, we realize that we all face changes. We all face challenges, but we don't have to do it alone. And we thank you that we can call upon the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, the King who walks with us, who loves us and cares for us. Bless us now as we come to this time of invitation, as we invite those who might need to accept you as Lord and Savior, or those who need to find a church home, and this is the place they want to join, to move their membership, to come on statement, whatever decision they need to make, Father, speak to them as only you can. For it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Stand with me, please, as we sing, I Have Decided. And if you have this morning, then you respond as the Lord speaks to your life.
Still will follow, no turn.